है कि लाइव फुटेज है, अपनी टेलीविजन स्क्रीन पर मुलाहजा कर रहे हैं वज़ीर आज़म इमरान खान सरमायाकारी कॉन्फ्रेंस में पाकिस्तान की नुमाइंदगी कर रहे हैं। सवाल और जवाब का ये सेशन इस वक्त आप देख सकते हैं।
Be part of the FII this year. I'm happy to see a full house and so many familiar faces in the audience. So we've got 40 minutes to discuss Pakistan's economy and to discuss the emerging opportunities that might provide. So good morning and thank you for making the time. Your Excellency, you've assumed office as Prime Minister in August 2018 with a mission to achieve Naya Pakistan, New Pakistan. Tell us more about it.
Well, thank you. First of all, let me say what a pleasure it is to be here. Opportunity to talk about Pakistan, investment opportunities. But Naya Pakistan is actually the Pakistan it was meant to be. Pakistan was the only state, well, one of the two states made in the name of an ideology which was Islam. So when we talk about Naya Pakistan, it is going back to the vision of the founding fathers of Pakistan. And what the founding fathers of Pakistan envisaged was a state based on the principles of the first Islamic state of Medina. And those principles were justice, meritocracy, a welfare state where the state took responsibility for the weaker section of the society, and above all, state to educate its people. So these were the principles, which very lofty principles, why Pakistan came into being. So when we talk about Naya Pakistan, it means going back to the principles of the what the founding fathers stood for. And hence the struggle to educate our people, develop our human resources, strengthen our institutions, especially of justice. You know, sadly for us, some of those principles are more visible in, say, the Scandinavian republics, say in Switzerland, say in New Zealand, then in Pakistan, what was supposed to be an example for what an ideal Muslim state was supposed to be.
You've mentioned so many important points that I'm going to go back to one by one. So working on human capital, fighting corruption, empowering the economy. Walk us through the economic agenda of your government now.
Well, you know, we have been in power for 60 days. We have inherited two big deficits, fiscal deficit, current account deficit. And so the immediate concern for our government is to increase our exports. We need to increase our exports because we have shortage of foreign reserves because of our current account deficit. We need to get more remittances through the banking channels, because there are about 8 to 9 million Pakistanis who work abroad, who are living abroad. So we need to bolster our foreign exchange reserves, immediate improvement in exports, giving incentives to the exporters, getting Pakistanis to send remittances through the banking channels, because then you know, we would have enough dollars. At the same time, clamping down on money laundering. It's a problem in most of the developing world, where the money leaves the country through illegal channels, and then create the opportunities for investment. So these are the immediate measures we have been taking in these 2 months, obviously, to get through this difficult period, we're looking for loans.
And that's actually my next question, because with such an ambitious agenda, you require resources. How does your government plan to overcome the existing financing gap? Are we talking about loans, IMF program? What are the options you have on the table?
Well, you know, whatever reforms we do today, the impact will be in maybe 3 months, 6 months, a year's time. So right now we need to have loans to go through this difficult period of repaying or servicing our debts for our imports. So we are talking to both IMF and also we are talking to friendly governments that we could have go through this difficult period to have get loans.
So you might be applying for another IMF program?
Yes, we're talking to the IMF. What we are hoping is that we can do a bit of both, get some loans from friendly governments, at the same time get a loan from the IMF. And so to go through this period, which we feel we have a tough period of corruption. And secondly, corruption diverts money from human development to mega projects which give mega kickbacks which leave a country indebted. So Switzerland is one of the most prosperous countries in the world because it has very good governance, it has strong state institutions, and it uses the money to develop its human resources. So in Pakistan the challenge is how do we strengthen our institutions enough to make it impossible for people to be corrupt, or corruption at a level which is manageable, and secondly divert the resources to develop our human resources. This is the challenge of Pakistan. So what we've been trying to do since we've been 60 days in power is to strengthen the state institutions, develop meritocracy. The reasons why state institutions get destroyed is because cronies have been put in key positions who then once there is no meritocracy in a state institution and there's no rule of law, the state institutions do not prevent anyone from stealing money from the country. So this has been the main agenda of our party. And then secondly, to prioritize institutions that will help the exporters. So hence we have made all the laws at the moment to help our exporters.
And unemployment also is the main concern for you. You've been very concerned about youth unemployment, training youth to be able to find jobs and creating jobs. Tell us more about the agenda in that particular field.
Pakistan has 100 million people below the age of 35.
Yes.
Now, in one way, that's a huge opportunity. But secondly, it is a big pressure on the government to find employment for this young population. We have embarked on a very ambitious program. Pakistan has 10 million shortage of houses. So we have embarked on this program that in the first 5 years, we will build 5 million houses. And so hence creating all the conditions, removing all the red tape that comes into the housing sector. Also, of course, trying to attract foreign investment for this housing. At the same time, apart from the housing, what we are trying to do is create the enabling environment for investment. One of Pakistan's strengths are the overseas Pakistanis. We have, as I said before, 8 to 9 million Pakistanis working abroad. We have, if we create the enabling environment, we will then be able to attract their investment. If you see the growth of China and India, one of the biggest, the first people who invested were the overseas Indians and overseas Chinese who came back. So we have this big resource lying outside Pakistan. Our main effort is to create the enabling environment, make it easy to do business, the ease of doing business, cost of doing, bringing down the cost of doing business and attracting this, investment.
Speaking of China, you've always spoke about how good China is in bringing 700 million people out of poverty. So And I think the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, or what you call CIPEC, is being debated a lot lately. And I would like to understand more about it from a Pakistan angle.
First of all, let me just say two things about China, which for Pakistanis is very attractive. One is that China is the only country in human history which brought out 700 million people out of poverty in 30 years. Secondly, China has in the last 5-6 years really clamped down on corruption. In the last 4 years, they convicted about 415 government ministers in corruption cases. So these are the two problems which face Pakistan. We have corruption, and so we are going to look for ways, because white collar crime is very difficult, especially in our countries, to catch, because we do not have the people.
Absolutely.
We do not have those who understand, who can convict white collar criminals. So we are going to get help from China. And secondly, all the way they have brought this huge amount of humanity out of poverty. So poverty alleviation is the second thing which we learn from China, and I'm going there next month. So we hope to, we've already asked the Chinese government to help us in these two areas. CPEC is a great opportunity for Pakistan. CPEC connects us to China, which is one of the biggest markets. Because of CPEC, we are developing Gwadar, which is, after Singapore, the second deepest port. And because of CPEC, we are developing these special economic zones where we will invite investments from all over. So hence, provided we get our governance structure right, CPEC is a great opportunity for Pakistan.
And actually, that leads to my second question, that this whole collaboration with China, how can it help Pakistan bring more international investors?
Well, simply because China is a huge market. Secondly, the CPEC is this route which connects us, China, right down to Gwadar. So we have all this opportunity with these special economic zones to invite people. It gives a great opportunity for investment. And remember, Pakistan's strategic position, it is sitting next to two of the biggest markets, India on one side, China there, and then, of course, inshallah, when peace returns to Afghanistan, then we have this all the way to Central Asia. So it's Pakistan is strategically probably, one of those countries blessed. It is placed in one of the great positions in the geography of the world.
And actually, I would like to comment on this point, but because rightly so, Pakistan is very well placed to connect Central Asia, Middle East, China, and the Eastern markets. Do you have a plan to leverage on that natural advantage?
The plan is to create the enabling environment in Pakistan so that we can attract investors. Not just foreign investors, not just overseas Pakistani investors, even our own investors who, unfortunately, because of our poor governance system, were not really investing in Pakistan. We didn't even give them enough incentives, and I'm talking about Pakistani investors. So we are restructuring our duty structure. We are our tax incentives. We are restructuring everything so to incentivize people to invest.
What are the sectors that you think investors would be more interested in Pakistan?
Minerals. There are vast amount of mineral wealth lying in Pakistan. Coal. We have one of the biggest coal reserves in the world. We have copper reserves, one of the biggest copper reserves, zinc. We have a lot of areas of gas which have not been explored at all. But then we have tourism. You see, Pakistan is one of the most diverse countries in the world. Pakistan starts with alpine in the north. We have alpine climate. And then from the highest, which is the second highest mountain in the world, which is K2, we go on to the sea. We have 12 climatic zones on the way. So we have tourism has exploded in Pakistan. Our infrastructure cannot cope with the tourists. So that's one of the biggest opportunities to invest in our country. And then we have three types of tourism. We have religious tourism. North of Pakistan was the center of the Buddhist civilization. We have the oldest civilization in the world, which is the Indus Valley civilization in Mohenjo-Daro. Peshawar is one of the oldest living cities in the world, 2,500 years old. Lahore, also one of the ancient cities. So Pakistan is a diverse country. It's unfortunately, because of the war on terror, last 13-14 years we had this turmoil where tourism disappeared. But in the last 2 years, we have all records of tourism have been broken in our country. So that's a great area to invest.
So you've mentioned 2 points, tourism and energy. You've spoken enough about tourism and what should happen and how the investment should be. But on
housing, housing is also, of course, 5 million houses we are building. That's another area we're expecting investment from abroad.
Let me talk about energy, because I think finding a sustainable fuel and gas supply by investing in Pakistan's own production is vital for your economy. What's your plan to reducing energy dependency and really inviting international investors and local investors to invest in that particular field?
You see, we have hardly had any investment in our mineral resources. And one of the reasons, as I said again, in the last 15 years was this war on terror, where we became the center of terrorism, suicide attacks, and so investors would not come to Pakistan. Then we had last 10 years very poor governance, corruption. We did not give enough incentives for investors to come to our country. Now, thanks to our security forces, our intelligence agencies, Pakistan has controlled terrorism. It's within Pakistan now, we have really clamped down on terrorism. It's very secure. We still have problems, terrorism coming from Afghanistan, but that's why we are hoping that these peace talks, hopefully peace talks between Taliban and the Americans, we hope that once Afghanistan settles, then not only will there be no terrorism within Pakistan, but then we have this access all the way to Central Asia. So we did not have investment coming into our gas, into our other minerals, because we had turmoil in our country. Now with peace and stability, we have people coming in. We have some of the big giants and in the energy sector now showing interest. In fact, in December, I think Exxon is coming in Pakistan. They're coming back to Pakistan. And also we want to give incentives for the people and the investors in the energy sector to come and invest in our country.
Your Excellency, from here, from the FII, what message do you want to give the world about Pakistan?
The message is that Pakistan is a country with great potential. In the 60s, Pakistan was growing faster than almost any country in Asia, and that's because we had the best governance system. We unfortunately lost our way. In the 80s, we ended up in what was the Afghan Jihad. We then had remnants of the Afghan Jihad throughout the 90s. 9/11, post 9/11, we suffered from terrorism. And then our governance system also, unfortunately, did not enable us to attract investment. Now, Pakistan, in my opinion, is ready. I repeat, the biggest resource in Pakistan are the 100 million Pakistanis below the age of 35. It's a huge potential in the country. We have a diverse mineral-rich country, one of the most fertile plains in the Indus Valley Basin. So today the country stands where it is probably right now is the best time for investors to come to our country.
Thank you very much. I'm going to open the floor now for some questions. We've got around 10 minutes. So if you have any questions, please just mention your name and your institution. We've got some mics.
I think I was very comprehensive.
Yeah. We've got so many questions. Can we just pass the mics, please?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Your Excellency, welcome to Saudi Arabia.
Okay, welcome.
Saudi Arabia businessmen are really very much looking at investment opportunities in Pakistan. We have a lack of information. I think we need to strengthen the economic section of the Pakistani embassy in Saudi Arabia, so that the Saudi businessmen have full information. We believe, from our experience, with the expertise of Pakistanis working in Saudi Arabia, who really shared with us our experience of development, they really show a potential to build a great country in Pakistan, like helping us to build a great country in Saudi Arabia. So we are looking forward to get more information about Pakistan, because many Saudi businessmen are interested for investment in Pakistan. Thank you.
Thank you. I have spoken to Prince, His Highness Prince Salman, and he is already organizing businessmen from Saudi Arabia to come to Pakistan to invest. So we look forward.
I'll take two more questions. Okay.
Hi, Imran. I'm Vikram from Tech Mahindra. Very inspirational talk. You did mention about 100 million people below the age of 30. And you mentioned about minerals and oil and gas. Don't you think information technology also could be an avenue for Pakistan?
Yes, Vikram. Information technology could be one area where we could not only improve our exports but also provide employment to our young people. Unfortunately, we did not concentrate like India did in information technology. We've got left a bit behind, but now we are concentrating, organizing our IT sector so we can develop it. Yes.
Assalamu alaikum, Khan Sahab. My name is Kashif Khan. I'm a private equity and investor from the Middle East. My question to you is, a lot of investors have invested previously in the past into Pakistan economy. The biggest challenge they have is exiting out of those investments. How this government will facilitate the previous investors to exit, which will give more confidence to the future investors?
Well, Kashif, I have my team here. Our chairman of board of investment is here, our finance minister, our commerce minister. The whole idea is, in Pakistan right now, is how to make it easier for people to invest, the ease of doing business. We are already working on it, trying to remove all impediments. In fact, we are now about to develop a one-window operation for investors, that anyone who wants to invest in Pakistan, he will just be able to contact a one point where they can contact, and any problems they are having, we will remove. So we are now determined that the only way the country can go forward and we can provide employment to this young population is by helping the investors. And you will find things improving by the day.
So we will have one more question before we wrap up.
Heather Henyan from Mindshift Capital.
Hello. Assalamu alaikum, Your Excellency. Welcome to Riyadh. Pakistan is one of the largest importers of oil, and Saudi being one of the largest exporters. So can you maybe shed light on the possibilities of potential cooperation in oil refineries or downstream opportunities in manufacturing in Pakistan?
Well, we are already talking to Saudi investors for an oil refinery to be built in Pakistan. In fact, we need two oil refineries in Pakistan bearing the amount of demand. So yes, the answer is yes, we are talking to Saudi Arabia. We have already met Saudi investors who just came over to Pakistan. And there is cooperation, and there's going to be increasing cooperation between Saudi Arabia and Pakistan.
So we have one more question. Okay.
Sorry, over here. Heather Henyon from Mindshift Capital. Just to ask about the gender strategy for Pakistan. We know that women have played a very strong role in microfinance, in the business of Pakistan, and in the formal economy of Pakistan. Can you talk more about the role that you see for women going forward as entrepreneurs and their role in the business sector? Thank you.
The most important thing at the moment for our government is to ensure that we raise a female literacy in our country. Unfortunately, in literacy we have got left behind in the subcontinent, but specifically female literacy. So you can only empower women really if you educate them. So in the 5 years when we were in power in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, the province our government was in power, we decided that every 100 new colleges to be built in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, 70 would be for women. Similarly, in primary, all primary education schools which we were going to open, out of 100, 70 would be for women. So that's number one. Secondly, we have this housing project which we've started. We are at the bottom tier, we are doing microfinance for the poorest of the poor. This is affordable housing. And for the poorest of the poor, we are introducing microfinance. And there also we are involving women, because we find that they are always in microfinance, they always pay back the loans much better than the ratio which men pay back. But apart from that, we're trying to do something which sadly hasn't happened in Pakistan. Women do not get their inheritance rights, which is mentioned in the Sharia. In Pakistan, in rural areas, women don't get their rights. So also financially empower them by ensuring that they get their inheritance rights.
So we've got another question, please.
Mr. President, this is Binhindi from Dubai, UAE. You have a great neighbor next to you, which is India, and they have great potentials to be a great partners with you. What is your efforts to let go all the past history and become one big nation, collaborating with each other in different fields and businesses? Thank you.
Well, I'll answer my final question. Look, one thing Pakistan needs more than any other country right now is peace and stability. The last decade or more, specifically after 9/11, has been of the greatest turmoil to our country. A war which Pakistan had nothing to do with. Pakistan ended up losing almost 80,000 Pakistanis dead. Our tribal areas devastated by the war. Half of the population in the tribal areas internally displaced. Over $100 billion lost to the economy. And one of the reasons why we are at the stage where I'm talking about the two biggest deficits, fiscal and current account deficit, is because of this instability and the war, where investment just dried up in Pakistan. So what we need is stability. Now, stability means peace with all its neighbors. We have peace with India, we have peace with Iran, peace with China and Iran. Our problems are right now with Afghanistan and with India. Now, when I won the elections and came to power, the first thing I tried to do was to extend a hand of peace to India. Unfortunately, and I think it's because of the Indian election coming up, and because, sadly, anti-Pakistan rhetoric brings in votes, I'm afraid we got no response from India. In fact, got rebuffed by India. Now, what we are hoping is that we'll wait till the elections, then again we will resume our peace talks with India. Peace with India is important not just for Pakistan, but for India as well. All the money that should be diverted to our human resources ends up being diverted to non-productive arms race. And secondly, peace with Afghanistan, peace in Afghanistan. It's critical for Pakistan because at the moment, the low amount of terrorism coming into Pakistan is from Afghanistan. And so it's for us, for Pakistan, it's extremely important that we have peace with both the neighbors. And I can tell you, my government will be trying its best. We are all in Pakistan, there is a consensus amongst all stakeholders that what this country right now needs peace and stability. And only peace and stability will allow us to bring in investment to most of all, to alleviate poverty, give employment to our young population.
So we will wrap it here. Thank you very much for joining us. Thank you. And thank you for sharing with us all this. The Prime Minister of Pakistan, thank you.